In this video, I'm going to show you three technically accurate, quick, and easy methods of taking your log footage and converting it into Rec709 color space. You can manually correct your log footage, but as I'm going to show you, it's faster, easier, and more accurate to use either a Rec709 conversion LUT, a color space transform, or finally, resolve color management. Which one you end up using is just going to depend on your preference and potentially the type of project you're working with. But I hope by the end of this video, you will at least want to try all three. And that way you can find which method is going to work best for you. Okay, so let's stop wasting time and get into the video. And the first thing I'm going to show you is why I would not recommend converting your log footage to Rec709 manually. So I'm going to jump over into color. And just going from this clip here, I'm going to close this down. So we have some space. I'll add another node. And on this node here, I'm just going to add in some contrast. So I'm going to crank that a little bit. It looks pretty decent. And then I'm going to come over here and just add in some saturation. Something like that. Okay, sure. That looks fine, doesn't it? Let's compare. The first method that I'm going to show you and the first method I'm going to compare to is taking log and converting to Rec709 utilizing a LUT. I'm going to come up here to my LUTs panel and I'll grab an official Sony LUT. So we'll start off that with that. So here's an SGamut3.cine2709. Yeah, here we go. So just double click that and there we go. Basically one click and we're done. Now, if we can pair that to the manual version. So here is our manual conversion. Here is the Rec709 conversion. And the difference is, you know, maybe not earth-shatteringly different. I think you can see a subtle but noticeable difference in the skin, or really in this area here. So here is the manual conversion, and here is the Rec709 LUT conversion. So I think in the Rec709 LUT conversion, you're getting more colors. You're getting more saturated and vibrant colors. So if you were just even to look at her hair, there as I wipe across is our manual conversion. And there is the LUT conversion. And if you were to look at her skin still seems just paler, more faded, and is lacking some of that, I don't know, complex hues that are in. I mean, they're there. They're just not coming out like they are in the conversion. And how to get them to come out, how to get the vibrance that you see here, you know, maybe you can add color boost, maybe you can do different things, but you're just taking more time to do something that really you can do with the click of a button, and you're ensured essentially that you're getting an accurate representation of what the camera is supposed to capture. So that's the conversion LUT. Let's look at the next method, which is going to be color space transform. And to do that, you come up to the top right and open up your effects panel and just come down here to color space transform and pull that over onto your clip. And it's going to open up this little menu, which is a little crazy. Don't worry, there's only a couple things here you need to input. You need to input your input color space and your input gamma. So it's going to depend on your camera and what picture profile you shot in. So for me, that's going to be SGamut3.cine and slog3. And there you go. That's all you need to do for output color space and output gamma. You can use timeline. So if you go to your project settings and come down to color management, this is going to output this color space. So it's going to output Rec709 gamma 2.4 or whatever you have this set to. So you can leave these as whatever your project settings are, and that's what these will be set to. If you want to verify, so if you wanted to make sure it's Rec709, you just come down to Rec709. Output gamma is going to be Rec709. And you can see that that did nothing. That just lets you know that if you do use timeline, that they're basically set to Rec709, as long as your settings match mine. If you're not shooting on Sony, they've got pretty much everything in here. Of course, they've got Blackmagic, they've got Canon. For these other settings, you typically don't have to mess with them. Like the input LUT, if something went crazy wrong, then you might want to mess with these tone mapping methods. By default, it should be on DaVinci. Luminance mapping in DaVinci, it's really just kind of has to do with like roll off and curves for highlights and shadows. So if I switch over to luminance mapping, you can see that didn't really do much in this clip here. One thing I know will make a difference is if you want to check saturation preserving. So watch the sky here change. Saturation preserving is pretty nice. It does start adding in a lot more saturation, obviously in the highlights, but you could see some of that sun coming in here, hitting these pillars a lot more and shining through your hair a lot better. So that's nice. I think this is a good option, especially if basically like a quick turnaround project, you don't want to do a lot to it. Saturation preserving could be a nice look because it does have a nice amount of saturation and everything looks good. Everything is still in bounds and you don't really need to do much. In terms of the order of operations for the color space transform, I don't know that there's any consensus to how you should start working either before or after the color space transform. My reading into it leads me to believe that you would apply the color space transform first and then start making any grades or any creative decisions, creative looks you want to afterward. And the reason that makes sense to me, at least, is because this is a conversion. So you're basically saying, I don't want to work in this color space. I want to work in this color space. So now that we're here, let's, you know, move on with our lives and start having some fun here. However, I have seen some pretty advanced colorists on YouTube who will apply this color space transform, you know, towards the end and then do some stuff before it. It doesn't really seem like it matters all that much. And the other reason that I think it makes sense to do it at the beginning here is when I show you the next method, which is the resolve color management. Jump over into our project settings and come down to the color management tab. And in this first box here, color science, click that. And then you want to apply DaVinci YRGB color managed. And for the purpose of this tutorial, I'm going to keep it simple. We're going to keep this checked, and then our color processing and color space are going to be SDR, SDR, Rec709. So once you've applied those, you just come down and hit save. Bada boom, bada bing. It has converted all of our clips to Rec709. So now we can just do our creative grade. And that just reinforces what I was saying about color space transforms being at the beginning. Because color management basically globally applied to the entire project. Basically anything we do from here on out is gonna be after that color management. So the color management has been applied to the project. Now here in the color page, everything we do on a node basis is gonna be on top of that color space transform. So that just makes sense to me that the color space transform then would be at the beginning. Let me undo that real quick. So I'm just gonna go back to that and that. And hit save. So the reason that this one is so awesome is that this works on a project basis, obviously because it's applied in the project settings. So just to reinforce that point here, here in our media page, so here's all the clips that are currently in this bin. A lot of these clips aren't even on our timeline at all. If you go to your project settings, color management, color science, color managed, save, boom, it applies it right here in the media pool. As an editor, you don't have to work with the log footage. So no matter what page you're in, whether that's cut page, edit page, fusion, etc., your footage has already been converted to Rec709. However, it's not going to be that easy for every camera. So that conversion, that automatic conversion, is reliant on basically file metadata. So the camera manufacturer has to apply or provide some metadata for Resolve to make that conversion automatic. But if it doesn't automatically make it, you're not out of luck. So all you need to do, you can do it right here with all the clips in your media pool if you want to, but you could do it really anywhere in the process, but it would just be easiest to do it here while you have all of your clips. So I'm just gonna select everything. And once all your clips are selected, you will just right click on one of them. And then just right here in the middle is input color space. And then you would just select the appropriate color space depending on your camera and the picture profile that you have. If you were shooting Fujifilm X-T4, you shot an F-Log, then here you go. Just choose that, and then it would just apply that conversion. Nikon N-Log, Panasonic V-Log, et cetera, et cetera. I hope that was clear. I hope you learned something from that. If you need me to clarify anything, please let me know in the comments or just say hi. That would be awesome. As always, I appreciate you watching the video, and hopefully I'll see you in another one.